Night Shifters on Reddit. What's your scariest story? I used to be a bouncer at several different locations in the Toronto downtown area. I enjoyed working on the patio when I could, despite not being a smoker, because talking to people made time go by faster and, hey, easier to get phone numbers. There was this one place I worked at that always had crazy shit happen. The patio was also a weak chain link fence with some tarp thrown over it. The club was cheap, so the fence didn't cover the entire area, so I had to be watchful of people trying to sneak in. One night, I felt lazy, so I stood in the opening with my back to the street. I was talking to some people trying to kill the time. I felt some guy stand behind, coming in from the street. This wasn't too unusual. Some people get turned away and, when they see me, try to bribe their way through the patio entrance. I was having none of it, so I puffed myself up, determined to ignore him until he gave up on me noticing him. After about 10 minutes of this, I started getting a bit creeped out, cause the guy was just standing behind me without saying or doing anything. I turned around to tell him to fuck off, but stopped mid-sentence. This guy was a bit taller than me, I'm 6 feet 2 inches, kinda lanky, very well dressed. He was also covered from head to toe in blood. Like completely drenched. I thought he'd been in an accident, so I dropped my tough guy act and started asking him if he was okay, needed an ambulance, etc. He calmly responded, "Nah, he's good. He just wants to find his brothers." I was like, are you sure your brothers are here? He insists that they are here, as they told him they'd be in X City, not anywhere near Toronto where the club is located. After his complete obliviousness to what city he's in, the fact that he's soaked in blood, and his intense stare, dude wasn't blinking, I called my boss up. When my boss appeared, I gave a quick rundown of what happened. He talked to the guy very briefly, then told him he'd assist. He went and got some patrolling cops. When the cops appeared, one of them lightly touched the bloody guy on the shoulder. That's when he started screaming incoherently and tried slashing at him with a small knife that had been concealed in his pocket. The cops, my boss, and I subdued the guy until he could be cuffed and placed inside a cop car. The guy was screaming loudly and struggling to hulk out of the cuffs, as the cuffs cut deeply into his wrists, the entire time. To this day, I still have no clue what the hell that was about. I was the control room supervisor at the nuclear plant I work at. 1 a.m. on a Saturday, nothing is going on, we are bored out of our mind. Out of nowhere, over 200 alarms come in all at once, along with the room lights flickering. I immediately turn and look. Usually flickering lights means we either had a large pump malfunction or a reactor shutdown, but we usually don't get 200 alarms at the same time. The next 10 seconds felt like 5 minutes as I'm trying to assess the status of the unit. As I turn my head from left to right, I see all my equipment is still functioning despite all sorts of system failure and trip alarms. When my head turns all the way right, I'm looking at the reactor and see it is still critical, despite reactor trip alarms being in. My blood pressure immediately shoots up and I see the rest of the crew notice the same thing. Why the hell was the core still online? Everyone was just staring at the full core display and the red control rod out lights that were still lit. Reactor scram failures are a huge deal. They are extraordinarily rare, only one has occurred in the US commercial nuclear industry. We train for them around 40% of the time, because they require rapid actions to make the reactor safe. So when you are sitting here questioning why the reactor is still online, it really drives up the anxiety. Is this really happening? And if it is real, you have around 2 minutes to commence taking actions to reduce core subcooling to prevent core damage. The reactor control operator starts reaching for the reactor scram switch and turns his head to look at me and says my name. I can see it in his eyes. His heart has to be pounding hard too. Him and I have worked together long enough that I already know what he's thinking. He wants to make sure at least one other person agrees with him before he punches out the reactor, so that if he's wrong, it's not a unilateral decision. He also is really hoping someone will tell him he's crazy and he needs to sit back down. I finally took a long deep breath, my first since the alarms came in. That breath re-energized my brain and got everything thinking correctly. I took a few extra seconds to scan the panels just to be absolutely sure. I was concerned we had to scram the core. We had reactor trip indications which should have shut the reactor down, but it was still online. But between that deep breath and those few extra seconds, I saw it as clear as day on one of my control boards, one of our power lines went down. I look up at the generator information screen and see that grid voltage just spiked off scale high then low and stabilized. I look back down and see some power grid circuit breakers tripped. The rest of the plant was stable, water level stable, power level stable, coolant flow and pressure stable. Right at that time the secondary reactor operator starts pointing at the power grid panel too. Everything made sense now. I raise my hand and say update, power line XXXX has dropped, we've had an electrical system perturbation, the unit remains online and stable. Everyone walk down your boards to verify system status and report back when you are complete. Reactor trip criteria was not met. Entering loss of power off normal. End of update. The reactor controls operator turns his head and sees the same thing I did, a power line went down. He nods his head, leans away from the mode switch, takes his own deep breath, presses the alarm silence button, and sits down. Just as fast as it started, I see everyone's anxiety level rapidly drop and we start clearing the alarms. I call up the power grid and they already had someone on their way to us. Apparently a vehicle struck a telephone pole and caused almost a mile of power line to go down pretty close to the plant. The field it was in was on fire as a result. It was pretty impressive. We've had issues in the past where a power grid perturbation from a lightning strike causes a few spurious alarms, but we've never had that many come in at once. Because the perturbation was that close to the plant, it caused a deeper perturbation and most of our alarm system basically rebooted. It's a solid state system so it can do that, causing all the false alarms. More than anything I felt our training and teamwork kick in. Using diverse indications to validate the condition, getting backup from the team, and taking a few seconds to stay level-headed. Our fundamentals kicked in and we made the right decision. Even though for about 15 seconds I almost needed a change of pants. I did my basic military training at Fort Leonard Wood in Missouri. Our barracks were old, dating to around the 1950s or 1960s. Every night, a number of recruits were assigned fire guard duty, which was essentially trying to stay awake for an hour and mopping the floor, or buffing it, until the next soldier came on duty. The fire guard post for my platoon was at one end of a long hallway, directly under a set of speakers suspended from the ceiling. Whenever the drill sergeants made an announcement, you'd hear them through the speakers. This is how they communicated reveille, wake up, and other instructions where they had to talk to the whole building at once. Usually these were communicated in blistering shouts, rendered staticky and nearly unintelligible as they blared through the ancient sound system. One night, about halfway through basic, so sleep deprivation really hitting hard by this point, I was sitting in a chair under the speakers, trying to stay awake. The speakers crackled to life, and I immediately perked up. Unusual for an announcement this time of night, but it wasn't outside the realm of possibility. The voice was soft, barely above a whisper. A woman's voice, "Private, get everyone outside. Right now." The comm line remained open, a low hum hissing through. The voice again, "Right now, private. Everyone outside." Weird. Not that it was a woman's voice, it was a co-ed basic training and we had a couple female drills. But for it to come across so softly was very strange. When the brown rounds used the intercom, it was at full, shouting voice. I headed down the length of the hall to where 2nd Platoon had a fire guard on duty similarly situated. Asked him if he heard anything, got a negative response. I made a decision, I'd chalk it up to my imagination and tiredness, and not risk having the entire barracks furious at me for disturbing their sleep in error. If it was one of the drill sergeants messing with me, and I got in trouble for not waking everyone up, at least I'd be the only one getting smoked. Nothing happened the rest of the night, and I put it out of my mind until the very end of basic, when we had our 3-day field training exercise. We made it through, and the drill started treating us like real humans, almost, again. As we completed the last day of the exercise, which was a near live fire night march to attack scenario, we all gathered around the fire. The drills got to talking, then got to telling stories, then got to telling ghost stories about the base. My drill, Perita, a male, told the story of the first female drill sergeant on Fort Leonard Wood. Can't remember when it was, 70s, 80s, but it was decades ago. Apparently she faced a lot of pressure and harassment, as you can imagine. It was unrelenting and harsh, and apparently she couldn't take it. She'd hung herself from some exposed water pipes, using her belt. A few years later, they'd plastered over the exposed pipes.